All right, so we're going to pick up at Luke chapter 22, verses 15 through 20. That's what's up on the slide, and if somebody would read those for us, I'd appreciate it.
I will. And he said to them, I dearly desire to eat the Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it again until it comes to fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.
Thank you, Kathy. All right, so last week I promised you we weren't going to do a whole bunch of maps and history every week. But we're going to have a few maps and just a short review of the history before we go on. Here, this map shows the Babylonian Empire. Babylon conquers Jerusalem in about 600 BC. They take all of the leadership away into Babylon as slaves. Then, along come the Persians, who conquer a whole big swath of the world, including Babylon, and they let the Israelites who want to go back to Jerusalem go back to Jerusalem. And people go back, but things never really feel quite right. It's not the way they thought it was going to be when they went back. Eventually, by Jesus' time, the people of Israel are subject to the Roman Empire. And they think the Romans are a bunch of pagans, and they are waiting to be freed from what they consider to be captivity and oppression. Another way of saying this is that they are, and here's that next new slide, they are waiting for a new exodus. They are waiting for somebody to lead them out of captivity from the Romans. And when they eat this Passover meal, here's another slide. You know how hard it was to find a picture that wasn't that famous Leonardo da Vinci painting or somebody who had copied it, maybe not all that well. It was not easy to find a different picture. I don't know who this is. I don't know who did this one. In eating this Passover meal, and many scholars believe that it's actually the night before Passover, which actually makes a lot of sense out of some parts of the story. Jesus puts together the story of the original Passover, where God sets the people free from Egypt. He's eating a Passover meal. He's putting that together with hope for deliverance from the Romans, the hope for a new Exodus, and his own life, and his coming death. He's putting all those together. The way John tells the story, now we read Luke, but in John's gospel, Jesus is referred to as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is truly the Passover Lamb. And he goes to the cross at the same time, as John tells it, that the Passover lamb sacrifices would have been slaughtered. So, whichever night it was, whether it's the night of the Passover or the night before the Passover, which I think makes more sense, it's clear that Jesus actually considers this the Passover meal, maybe because he knew he wasn't going to be able to eat the Passover meal with his disciples the next night. And there are some scripture passages which justify eating the meal on a different night if that's what you have to do. If you'd like to go read Numbers chapter 9, they talk about it there. In 2 Chronicles chapter 30, there's reference to a feast of the Passover being celebrated on a date that would have had nothing to do with where Passover shows up on the Jewish calendar. And in any event, the symbolism of the Passover festival and the Passover meal is, on this night, focused on Jesus. Jesus and his disciples are remembering the people leaving slavery in oppression. They're remembering the Exodus. And they're celebrating the meal that says that Israel's God, not Pharaoh, not some pagan emperor, is the real king and the real God. Now, this meal symbolizes forgiveness of sins. When we American Christians think about forgiveness of sins, we think about the stuff that we did wrong yesterday that we're sorry for, right? That's mostly how we think about that. But if you were a first century Jew thinking about forgiveness of sins, you were thinking on a whole bigger scale than your personal foibles or mistakes. A first century Jew would have understood forgiveness of sins as including the forgiveness of Israel's historical sins against Yahweh, meaning, to summarize, they didn't love the Lord their God, they didn't worship only the true God, and they didn't love their neighbors as themselves. And this meal symbolizes forgiveness of all of that, plus the fact that God was coming to redeem his people and then renewing the covenant or entering into a new covenant with the people. Jake reminded me Sunday that as Luke tells the story of the Transfiguration, and I put this in the Bible passages that are on your table. Luke 9, verse 31. Jesus, Moses, and Elijah are together on the mountain of Transfiguration, and they are discussing Jesus' departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment in Jerusalem. Now, if you look under there on that sheet of paper, you'll see a note that says departure. The literal Greek word is in fact exodus, or in English, exodus. They are discussing Jesus' exodus, which was going to be fulfilled in Jerusalem. Jesus is speaking with Moses and Elijah about his death and his resurrection with a word that links them to God saving the people out of Egypt. So this all ties together. One way that Jesus understands his ministry, it's only one way that he understands his ministry, but he does understand his ministry as a new exodus, where he actually becomes the lamb that is sacrificed and whose blood serves to set the people free. His sharing of the bread and the cup. Here's the next slide. His sharing of the bread and the cup are symbolic actions like those of several of the Old Testament prophets, which we'll talk about more when we do another series later about Jesus and the prophets. Jesus is in fact, not just symbolically, in fact, going to give his body and his blood as a way of bringing the kingdom of God. Way of setting people free in an unexpected way and completely reinterpreting the Exodus. The takeaway of this, I think, has to do with the importance of worship and ritual and story. The contemporary takeaway for us. Worship helps us establish and maintain our identity. Much of what we do in worship is done in some sense with perhaps detailed instructions. Read the pastor's guide to using the hymnal. It's pretty thick. But there's not detailed explanation of why we do what we do. We come to worship, I hope, hoping to have an experience of the presence of God. That's at least one of the things that we're looking for when we come to worship. And then later, we do the theology to try to explain as best as we can in our limited human language what it is that happened in worship and how it is that we experience God's presence. But our worship is always tied to a story. For Jewish people, all of worship, not just the Passover festival, is tied in some way to the Passover story, which we could think of as the Easter moment for Judaism. On the other hand, Jesus' death and resurrection together are the Passover event of Christianity. The New Testament sees Jesus as the final sacrifice, the final Passover lamb. Jesus' Last Supper, instituted one night during Holy Week, becomes for us the Lord's Supper or Communion, which is regularly part of our worship service and part of our ritual. And with that, we have a second set of discussion questions related to Luke 22. I invite you to discuss these at your tables. We'll take up to about 15 minutes, and then again, we'll report back before we go home for the night.